Okay, good morning. I'm Venkat Padmanabhan from Microsoft Research India. And as Amit mentioned, I'll be talking about some work that we are doing on improving, and hopefully improving road safety using sensors and AI and so on. This is a joint work with a bunch of people. Akshay is a key contributor to the project. He's sitting back there. There's a bunch of students we've had working with us. And we're also reaching out to academia and working with IIIT Hyderabad, Jawahar is in the audience here, IIT Bombay, as well as ISC. So what is the problem? I think the problem is very, familiar at one level, but also unfamiliar at another level, because if you've ever been involved in any of these, you wouldn't be in the audience here today. But a lot of people are dying on the roads, and the problem is particularly acute in countries like India, where depending on who you believe, one person is dying every 4 minutes on the road, or 250,000 people roughly are dying every year. And it's a global problem. If you look at causes of death around the world, road injury or road accidents is in the top 10. So it's like a public health issue as well. Now, why is the problem there? So we believe fundamentally the issue is that if you look at the factors that impact safety, I don't know why it's jumping ahead, the vehicle, the driver, and the infrastructure, none of these actually is being monitored on any ongoing basis. So for example, the driver, you might be tested when you get a license. In some cases, you don't even get tested, you get a license anyway. But then after that, no one really watching how you're doing. Likewise with the infrastructure and so on. So all of these factors matter. But in our work, we are focusing primarily on the driver, and I will explain why. And what we're building is a very low-cost system to monitor the driver and their driving, right? And the word sort of harnessing comes from the fact that we're putting a smartphone in front of the driver, and that is acting like a harness. It's sort of hopefully constraining the driver and making him or her do better than they would otherwise do. And we've had a data collection system on a bunch of cabs at Microsoft running for about a year. We've collected a bunch of data from Bangalore roads. The data includes data from all of the sensors that a typical smartphone has, the front camera looking at the driver, the back camera looking out to the front of the vehicle, GPS, inertial sensors, and so on. And our goal is to go beyond what people have done with smartphone-based monitoring in the past. In fact, 10 years ago, a bunch of us at Microsoft Research India did a project where we looked at a smartphone of that time, which was this HP iPack, which had no real sensors, attached some external sensors to it with Bluetooth and so on, and actually went about measuring things like sharp braking and speeding and so on. And this general idea has actually taken off. There's a bunch of startups and so on who are doing what's called smartphone-based insurance telematics, where they're measuring how people are driving and so on. But if you look at our past work and a lot of the work that's happening in companies, it's really about collecting GPS data and inertial sensor data to detect braking and speeding and things like that. What we are looking to do with HAMS is to add more context. So basically use cameras to understand the state of the driver and also the context in which they're driving, right? Because a particular behavior, speed, may be perfectly fine in a given situation, but quite unsafe in a different situation depending on what's around you, right? So we need more context, and that's really what we are looking to add. Now, our hypothesis is that if someone follows good driving practices, that actually make things safer. It's just article of faith, and I will talk about other studies, but we really are not, we're just assuming this. The question we want to answer is whether monitoring someone, like sort of watching someone, actually makes them follow the rules better, right? And that's something that we hope, we have not answered it yet, that's something that we hope we will answer. Now, there's a bunch of studies, this is from WHO, that look at what are the factors that impact safety and cause accidents and so on. And pretty much all of the top factors have to do with drivers. Occasionally an accident may happen because your tire burst or there was a pothole, and unfortunately it's happening quite often in Bangalore. But the majority of accidents and deaths and so on are because of actions of humans, in particular the drivers. So now you might say, drivers are to blame, shouldn't we all do self-driving cars? And that's obviously happening. But there is also the reality you have to deal with, which is that, and not just in India, there's chaotic environment, but there's cost involved in doing driverless driving. The driverless cars, there's a huge installed base of vehicles that's not going to disappear overnight. So it'll be a while before drivers disappear. So we believe it is still worthwhile looking at drivers and monitoring them. So, using the inward-facing camera, we are monitoring a bunch of driver behaviors, distraction, fatigue, gaze, and so on. I'll talk about the gaze a bit in subsequent slides. And then using the outward camera, we're getting more of the context, how far you are from the vehicle in front, speeding. Speeding is an interesting one, It's sort of one thing to say someone is going at 80 kilometers an hour, but you know, are they going at 80 kilometers an hour when everyone else is going at 60, or they're going at 80 when everyone else is going at 100? So that matters, right? So you have to look at that. This is, I don't know why this is, okay, anyway. You know, wrong side driving, which is quite prevalent in India. So let me, in the interest of time, skip. So basically, you know, collecting raw sensor data, processing it, and sort of building applications. And one thing is, of course, to keep costs low and, of course, also improve privacy, all of our processing, raw data, is processed at the edge device itself. We are not shipping raw data to the cloud. As part of our data collection, we have gathered data so that we can, you know, fine-tune our algorithms. But in this actual system and deployment, the idea is to do all of the processing at the edge device itself. So let me talk about driver gaze tracking, right? You know, where a driver is looking is quite important from a sort of safety viewpoint. You know, if someone's, whether they're scanning their mirrors or not. So are they situationally aware? Are they aware of what's around them? Are they, you know, looking at something interesting while on the side of the road while driving? Are they texting, looking down while driving and so on, right? Now, so you need to sort of estimate the pose of their head and also which way their eyes are looking. And these are well-known problems in computer vision. Now, the challenges, though, are that in our situation, you know, compared to typical situations where these may have been done, like, you know, someone sitting in front of a computer doing a web conference where, you know, occasionally their head may move, the driver's head and eyes are moving all the time. So, you know, being able to track these is a bit of a challenge. Also, the camera position, you know, you don't put a camera directly in front of a driver because that'll cause an accident, right? So you put it somewhere where instead of it's a bit hidden. So the driver is not looking at the camera, so you have to sort of deal with that. And also there's driver and vehicle specific variation. You know, driver is a 6-footer, they might sit some distance away from the steering wheel, and someone who's shorter might be. So, you know, what it means to be looking in a certain direction is different for different people. So, you know, we're not vision people, so we're taking sort of a lot of existing techniques, but then we are trying to sort of refine them for our situation and also make them more efficient, right? So, for example, we have to deal with a much larger range of, you know, yaw angles when someone's driving, because they may look at the left mirror, the right wing mirror, they may look straight sometimes, and so on, right? So, also we'll look at eyes things. So,
what is the difference?
That's a good question. I think a more pertinent question is, what's if it's pitch dark, nighttime, you can't see anything, and we have some things we're doing for that as well. You know, if they're wearing sunglasses, that's a good one. I guess they should not be driving maybe any sunglasses. So, you know, going back to what I was saying about dealing with variations, one question is, can we automatically cluster all the gaze data that we are getting, with the head pose as well as eyes, to identify when someone's looking straight, when they're looking right, and when they're looking left, right? The assumption is that these are the three dominant things, right? So, you know, most of the time you're looking straight, and then you're looking at your mirrors, and other things are random and occasional. And so it turns out that, you know, with some massaging and so on, we are able to generate these clusters in a completely unsupervised way. So what that leads to is this architecture where, given a drive or a driver, when they start, for the first several seconds, I think about n is about 1,000 frames, so which is maybe 30 seconds, we assume, yeah, that, you know, they are showing the full range of movement, and we identify these clusters corresponding to left, right, and straight. And then after that point, the rest of the drive, we can automatically classify their gaze. Let me quickly talk about, so this is a video where, you know, this guy, so it says right, and then it'll say straight, yeah, straight, and so it sort of, it's constantly tracking their gaze in these three classes. Yeah, so let me move on. So, you know, I talked about mirror scanning, so you could sort of do things like this where you can, and this is not something, this is just for demo purposes, but you can sort of see for how long has someone not scanned at all, right? For 30 seconds, if you're driving without being aware of what's around you, that's not good, right? So you can sort of, you know, raise alerts based on that. The other thing is sort of vehicle ranging, so looking, using the back camera, looking out to the front, how far are you from a vehicle in front? And this is, again, a very standard problem. People use LIDARs and look, use a lot of other sensors to do this. Those are expensive. Plus, you have to deal with, you know, the heterogeneity of vehicles and the fact that there are no lanes and so on. And so, again, we use vision techniques. The challenge here, though, is that if you apply the best vision techniques for detecting vehicles and bounding boxes, they're very expensive. They run very slowly, right? So the approach we're taking is a hybrid approach where we combine a deep learning approach to find the bounding boxes with cheaper tracking approaches where, you know, once you find the bounding box, you can track it for several frames without having to do the expensive computation. So, you know, you occasionally do the expensive stuff, and then you do the blue stuff much more frequently, and you're able to track the bounding boxes. And here is just a video of, you know, I guess somewhat controlled setting where we had two of our office cabs, one in front, and, you know, you will see as that guy moves, the range estimate will change. So it went from 9 meters to 8 meters. I don't know how to speed it up, but so anyway, you get the idea, right? So that's what's happening. Now, finally, just in terms of application scenarios, we believe there is a bunch of applications where this could be applied. And one that we are focusing on is driver training. I'll talk about that in a couple of slides. Time over. OK, so just 1 minute. We are missing a speaker, right? So I get a bit of extra time. Sorry. So driver training. The next thing is driver licensing, right? So you can think about, you know, cutting out the corruption, or at least reducing corruption in things like licensing, where in addition to the inspector saying yes, the device has to say yes, this person is knows how to drive. And it's also the person who actually is getting the license, right? Because you can do face recognition and things like that. Fleet management, we believe, is big. Now, fleets are everywhere, truck fleets, bus fleets, cab fleets, and so on. And if you're a supervisor, you have very little visibility into what's happening. You don't even know whether your truck is being driven by your driver or whether his friend is driving it, right? So there are a bunch of things that you can do about monitoring. So with regard to driver training, we are working with Maruti IDTR. So until a year ago, I was not aware of IDTR, but actually it's quite big. IDTR is initiated by Maruti from about 20 years ago or 18 years ago, where they are looking at imparting safe driving training. Safe training, sorry, safe driver training. Well, whatever, I'm mixing up the words, but basically making drivers better drivers, right? Safe drivers. And they have 7 centers, mostly in North India, although they're opening something in AP very soon. I think I mentioned to the IIIT people, although they said that's the enemy state now, so it's Andhra Pradesh. There's also about 400 odd Maruti driving schools all over the country. And they've trained 3 million drivers so far, right? And they're very forward looking. They're looking at adding sensors, and they have these tracks. So this is what the setup looks like. You know, they have free land from the government or subsidized land from the government in various locations. And they've recreated this nice setup with signals and crossings and all those things. Things you'll not see on the outside. You'll only see them here, you know, all these road markings and all that. And this guy's being trained. And that guy's job is to monitor him. So you see, he's looking at a lot of other things as well, right? You know, at the end of this, he is supposed to fill out a form like this, which says how the driver did. You can't read all of this, I know, but you know, the observation that the driver made, like, did the driver look out to their right before they did a right turn? Or did they look at the rear view mirror before reversing their vehicle and so on, right? There's also things around speed and distance. I just call these out because these relate to the detectors we have worked on. And the challenges are it's very hard for the instructor to monitor all these. And as I said, you know, if you've only trained in that setup, you're only good for a parking lot in California, right? You cannot drive anywhere else. If you go out in the real world, you don't have any of the other infrastructure. So if a mobile device can monitor things, that's pretty good. So we're working with them, and we are deploying some of our detectors there. And this is my last slide. So thank you.
Any quick questions?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, we have not done that. Actually, we have thought about that for example, drunk driving, right? That's a huge issue. How do you check whether someone is drunk? Well, first of all, leave aside the problem of it's difficult to get training data, right? how do you actually check? So we were wondering, like, you ask someone a question and see how their voice sounds. But I'm told, again, I don't drink, but I'm told that it is well beyond the point of, you know, you become an unsafe driver well before your voice and other things start showing that, right? So I think it's an interesting question. If someone has a good idea, I think.
Smell detector,
yeah. I don't know how, are those sensors easy to
switch it? It's a motion thing. There's actually some work being done by people in the alcohol abuse where they're using cell phone sensors to just detect imbalance, essentially. And so like people's motions can be used.
Yeah. So anyway, yeah. So I think it's a good point. I mean, if you can tap into the humans, emotional state and so on, I think that would be helpful, yeah. There's one other question, I think, yeah.
Was there anything interesting about the reactions of the drivers? How did they react?
I think they are very excited. I guess they don't know what they're in for now, but we showed it to them. It's in a fairly early stage. They and their supervisors, actually, you know, I think we showed it to the supervisors, and they are very happy because they are able to get a view that they are not able to see today, right? The drivers, I think it's too early to tell how they will react. I think for a training setting, it's quite harmless, right? I mean, you're after all there to learn, and so you're probably okay. I think fleets and so on is where interesting question is, because as a driver, you might feel offended that you're being tracked, but on the other hand, it's your job and you're sort of making sure that, yeah.
So the state of a driver is very much dependent on the context. For example, on an extremely familiar route, the driver may be very comfortable and so on.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas if the route is not familiar at all,
mm-hmm.
then the pattern may be very different.
Right.
So is there a way of modeling the context?
No, that's a very good question. Yeah, so I think, you know, context is important. Saying something is safe or unsafe in absolute terms doesn't make sense. This particular thing we have not really thought about, although I would say even if it's a familiar route, the vehicles right in front of you are different every day, right? So you have to pay attention to the road regardless, yeah.
Okay.